Well, hallelujah. Praise the Lord. You know, I love that word. Hallelujah. And it's beautiful to be able to say that because it means praise God. Lord, you're the highest in the glories of heaven and are our Lord of Lords. Hallelujah. So we want to welcome everybody today. It's that time. We're going to get started with our service. So we welcome everyone in the auditorium. We welcome everybody that's watching from the video. And, you know, we get more and more people contacting me about they've watched the video. And some of them, once in a while, will not get it on or start late. And, boy, they want to know, what happened? Where's the video? We won that. So, anyway, I'm glad you're here, though. Can you say amen? That's the thing. We were trying to encourage people. Come on, get back to church because, boy, that long spell we went through, COVID and all that, but God's raising us up. Hallelujah. And so we're going to have a really great day today. Let's invite the Holy Spirit and say, come, come, Holy Spirit. That's what the word says, to pray, come, Holy Spirit. So, Father in heaven, we come to thank you for your grace and your love. We thank you, Lord, that you sent us the Holy Spirit. And we now welcome the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, we welcome you. You're a person, and we know you. And we ask you now to come and touch hearts. Speak to us today. We know you've got a word for us. And we're looking forward to hear that, and so we give you praise. Now, we just ask you, Lord, to help us just open our hearts and to join in and worship you in spirit and in truth. Hallelujah, in Jesus' name. Amen. Pastor Toby Hall, come on.
Let's go to the cross.
Alas, and did my Savior plead, and did my Sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for a sinner such as I? Was it for crimes that I had done? He groaned upon the tree. Amazing pity, grace unknown, and love beyond degree.
Where?
At the cross, at the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there, my faith, I received my sight.
Cross. I'm not my own, I've been bought with a price. I was purchased by the precious blood of Jesus Christ. All my debts were paid by his sacrifice. Hallelujah to the Lamb who redeemed my life. I am not my own, I've been bought with a price. I was purchased by the precious blood of Jesus Christ. All my debts were paid by his sacrifice. Hallelujah to the Lamb who redeemed my life. I am not my own, I've been bought with a price. I was purchased by the precious blood of Jesus Christ. All my debts were paid by his sacrifice. Hallelujah to the Lamb.
Sake he made him who knew no sin to become sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. For our sake he made him who knew no sin to become sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God.
Pure and holy.
Lord, prepare to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving.
With thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary for you.
I can't really hear myself.
Yes, indeed, Lord. Yes, indeed. This is an Irish song, I believe. It sounds Irish.
Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me, save that thou art. Thou my best thought, by day or by night, waking or sleeping, thy presence my life. Be thou my wisdom, and thou my true word. I ever and thou with me, Lord. Thou my great Father, I thy true Son. Thou in me dwelling, and I with thee one. High King of heaven, my victory won, may I reach heaven's joys, bright heaven's sun. Heart of my own heart, whatever befall, still be my vision, O ruler of
heart of my own heart.
Heart of my own heart, whatever befall, still be my vision, O ruler of all.
Reign, Jesus, reign.
Reign, Jesus, reign. King of Zion, Judah's lion, reign, Jesus, reign. Reign, Jesus, reign. Reign, Jesus, reign.
Lord, we lift you high up and exalt you this morning, Lord. Reign in our lives. Reign amongst us in our midst, Lord. Reign all over this world, Lord. Come and reign. You are reigning, you high and above all. And we're so grateful to be able to say we are yours. We've been bought with the price you paid for us, and we are yours, and we invite you now to come and rule and reign by the power of your mighty grace in our lives and in this world. In Jesus' name, amen.
Praise the Lord. I appreciate the music this morning. You were bringing the Lordship to King Jesus. Hallelujah. King of Kings, Lord of Lords. Hallelujah. And so we are in a place of being able to honor the Lord. And that's why we come. We come for that, see, to honor the Lord. And we come for many, maybe other reasons as well. We love to worship and we enjoy the music and many things. But it's really about honoring Jesus. It's about honoring him. And, you know, I know, Pastor Roberts, we've talked about this. As younger men, we were taught. Folks, that's right, Brother Scott, we were taught. To you go and honor the Lord. And I've told you this before, but my folks, we go on a vacation. In a strange town, my dad would check it out and find out where a church was. So we would go to church and honor the Lord, you know, at the house of the Lord. And so those of you that are coming and are faithful, I know that's in your heart. Praise the Lord. And many of you have expressed that. But it's what it's all about. Isn't that right, church? Hallelujah. It's what it's all about. So we're going to move now to a time of prayer. And Pastor Ron is going to come and share any of the needs that he needs to let us aware of, because he keeps up with that really well. And he's a great man of prayer. So come, Pastor Ron.
Thank you, Jesus. Okay, so we have a couple of prayer praise reports. Mary apparently is being able to eat and keep some of it down now, so that's a praise report. Pastor Mike's sister is being responsive now, and she's able to talk. And they think it was
yes,
the medication.
The Lord's touching my sister.
Yes.
She's getting back to normal. Hallelujah.
So that's
thank you for prayer.
That's a couple of praise reports. Then we got some prayer requests. Alex, his friend, apparently was playing with some fireworks, and I guess he's lost now a couple of four fingers.
Oh, wow.
He's 16 years old.
Wow.
So... and we need to pray for him. We need to keep praying for Gloria, that God raise her up completely. He's doing a work in her, and that God complete the work.
Amen.
We need to keep praying for Dale, that God slow things down, and the MS slows down and maybe takes a few steps back so they're able to do a few more things now. And Debbie isn't feeling good today. She's going through a lot of stuff with her... burning skin and stuff like that. We need to pray for Pastor Mike, that Pastor Mike continue to raise up and be completely healed.
Getting better and better every week.
Praise God.
And we need to just pray for families, that God brings the families in, that they come back to know Jesus.
And Scott.
And Nancy. Nancy's having a routine surgery. Okay. And Scott, we need to pray that he gets healed of whatever liver problem it is.
Yeah.
And that God raises him up. And so. All right, so let's just go to prayer.
Well, Lord, first of all, I pray for this 16-year-old boy, Lord. I ask that you just touch him, Lord. And if he doesn't know you, Lord, that you just bring him into your fold and let him know that you're right there with him. Wrap your arms around him and let him know that he's alive because of you, Lord. Yes. That this explosion that happened in his hand, that he's alive because you protected him, Lord. And, Lord, I ask that you just touch this young man right now and that you just minister to him in, right now where he's at, Lord. And, Lord, I hold Gloria up to you. I ask, Lord, that you just complete the work in Gloria and that you just raise her up, Lord, and do the work that you're doing. And it's encouraging just to see her come to church every day, Lord, every Sunday, Lord. And I pray for Debbie, Lord. She's at home. She's not feeling good. And I ask that you just touch her, Lord. Yes. This burning skin and everything has got to stop. The nausea, everything has got to stop. And I just pray for healing in Debbie's life, Lord. And, Lord, I pray for Dale. I ask that, Lord, right now that you slow the progression of the MS down and that it moves backwards, Lord, and that they're able to do a few more things than what they used to be able to do, that she's able to get out of the house and do the things that they used, some of the things that they used to do, like going to the grocery store and stuff like that, Lord. And I pray for Mary. I thank you for the healing in Mary, Lord, and I ask that you just continue to work in her and just touch her completely, Lord, and just raise her up, Lord, and just let her be able to eat a full meal and keep it down, not just little bits and pieces here and there, Lord. And, Lord, I pray for Scott. I ask that you just touch him right now, that you heal his liver, Lord. Whatever is going on inside of his liver, Lord, I ask that you just touch him right now and that this liver be completely healed, Lord. And I pray for Nancy. She's going in for a routine surgery, that everything just goes smoothly. Everything goes as it's planned. Everything is okay, and that there be no residual damage, Lord. And, Lord, I pray for Pastor Mike. I ask that you just touch him and completely raise him up, Lord. Give him a new back. Straighten out that back completely, Lord. And I thank you for his sister, that his sister is recovering. And I ask that you just give her the strength right now to get up and do the things that she needs to do, Lord. And, Lord, I just pray for everybody's family, Lord, everybody that has loved ones out there that aren't serving you, Lord, that you just let them see Jesus in us, Lord, and just draw them back in. Let them remember the things that they were taught, and you draw them back into the fold, Lord. And whatever I've forgotten, Lord, I ask that you just, you know our needs, you know our hearts, you know everything that we about us, Lord. And I just claim victory in each and every life. In your name, amen.
Yes, amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Beautiful. Amen. And, you know, I'm so thankful. The Lord is really lifting me up. And it's been your prayers. I really know. Church, you've been standing in faith with us. And the scripture says that we're supposed to agree with one another in prayer. There's power in the prayer of agreement. And so I love it when we get on the internet, you know, and you guys are sending text messages back and forth when these prayer requests come. And it's inspiring. But, you know, I have to say again, Gloria, you really blessed me this week. She sends these little text messages, but God's given you a gift, Gloria, to be able to know how to pick those. I mean, they're just a little couple of lines, but man, always got an impact. There's an anointing that comes through that and touches us. So praise God. Thank you very much for that. Amen. And so I wanted to share a little before we move on to the word, but some of you have already seen this. There's a little flyer that we made up, and I got inspired because I knew it was Palm Sunday. And Pastor Roberts and I, we've talked back and forth about Palm Sunday, you know, and it's going to be a glorious time. And, you know, that's we'll bring in some those palms, leaves, and things. But I was able to put it on the little flyer. I got this picture of the palms, and I said, you know what? That would be perfect. And so we're wanting to get the word out. Now, pass it on, church, to your friends. Tell people, listen, Palm Sunday's coming next Sunday, and we're going to have a glorious time. Now, look at this. We're going to have family members. Pastor Roberts and Lady Crystal is a daughter coming down from, what, up Oregon or someplace. Wow. And some grandchildren. And Malachi will be on the drums. Man, you talk about. And here's the thing. The next Sunday is Easter Sunday. And I've got my message raring to go. I'm telling you, man. I'm so excited about being able to. I love preaching. Easter is a big day. And you know what I'm going to go with. I'm going to be preaching on the grand opening. Lord gave me that idea about 10 years ago, and I shared it. But, man, it's rising up in me. I've got something to say about it. And so that's the following Sunday. Hang on. Hang on. You might want to tighten your seatbelts. But on the 7th of April, I got a call yesterday. Doyle Dykes said, I'm going to be passing by your area, and maybe I could come on your service that day. And April 7th, I looked at, I said, you know, Easter's early this year. So it's going to work out for you to be here. And I'll tell you what. So what I first said, actually, was, he said, can you have me that day? I sent back, hallelujah. And I said, absolutely. That made me think of Dapo Shibomaim. We had a brother from Nigeria that was in our ministry down at UCLA, and that was his word. Absolutely. I love that. Absolutely. So praise God. Listen, we've got three blockbuster Sundays coming here. I'm telling you, look around and you'll see. It's exciting. And how can we end up with all this? I'm telling you, the truth is divine favor. Divine favor. God's smiling on us, and I believe it's because of your love for God, your faithfulness, your commitment to help and be a part. And listen, dear ones, we got to get the word out. Can you help us get the word out and contact your family and friends and whoever, your neighbor, and tell them, listen, we got some great stuff coming, and you're going to love it. So get here for Palm Sunday. Get here for Easter Sunday. And get here to hear Doyle Dykes. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Well, you know, you have to excuse me. I get a little excited. But there's something worth being excited for. Praise God. And, you know, I've talked to some of my friends, and they shake their head, and they say, I don't know how in the world. How come you keep coming up with these kinds of powerful times? And I've told them the same thing I told you. It's favor. It's divine favor. And I'm going to tell you this, dear ones, you have divine favor on you, every one of you, because it's a part of, it's a package deal. When you find the Lord and you step into his life, it's a favor. Hallelujah. The grace of God that comes upon you. Amen. Well, I better calm down. I'm going to get to preaching here, but I got a good speaker. And listen, I'm going to tell you what. The Blockbuster Sundays actually already started today. Hallelujah. Because we've got a great speaker, and she's getting better and better all the time. Everybody's enjoying her ministry, and I know you love it when she shares. So we have got Pastor Roxanne. Hallelujah. And she's coming today, and you want to be down below? Oh, okay. She's helping me. See, let's have you come to the piano, and we'll get somebody to help get the stand over, and we'll get the mic later. But let's praise the Lord through giving. How's that? Right. Amen? You know, praising God through giving is one of the most joyful and powerful things we can do, because it blesses the Father God to hear that we're stepping up. Amen? That's his plan for us. And he wants us to stand with getting the word. Hallelujah. So, Roxanne, bless us with something, and we'll come worship with our giving. Praise the Lord.
Okay. What's in my mind is old-time religion. But I can't sing it. Can you sing it? Give me that old-time religion. Give me that
old-time
religion.
Give me that old-time religion. It's good enough for me.
Makes you love. Give me that old-time religion.
Give me that old-time religion. Give me that old-time religion. It's good enough for me. Hallelujah. Give me that old, one more time, time. I want that, don't you? Give me that old-time religion. Give me that old-time religion. Well, it's good enough for me. It will keep the fire burning. It will keep the fire burning. It will. It will keep the fire burning. And it's good enough for me. Hallelujah. Give the Lord a clap offering. Praise the Lord. Man, I tell you, I got blessed looking back there seeing you, Rose the auntie, and she's singing that song, and she's,
she knows.
Man, I'm telling you, she's getting into that. Hallelujah. She knows about that old-time religion, I'm telling you, and so do you. Praise the Lord. You know, a lot of the modernized styles are, you know, out there all the time, and we try to not get too far behind. We like to know a little bit. But at the same time, some of those things that we experienced back in the day, you know, I saw that Dr. Phil is going to be on the TBN now. He's going to have a whole program. They're raising up a whole network that he's going to be in charge of, and he's going to be on the air, and he's talking and telling people about why we need to go back to the principles that we've had for 250 years. That's what he said. Wait a minute. 250 years of success because of, and he says, it's Christian values. But he said, you know, I can't get out on the air and preach the way they want because I don't want to hinder some of the other things going on. But he said, I can't wait. He said, I gotta get with the program and get up and tell people the truth. And he's written a new book. I encourage you. You should follow him when he's on. You should listen to what he says, because he says people have wanted to know what to say about some of these inconsistencies, and they're not telling the whole truth. So he said, I've written a book to explain how to handle that. So, you know, I want to throw that extra in, and no extra charge. You take it as you want and go from there. But we don't preach a party line. We preach a gospel line. Can you say amen? And whatever the Lord uses in your heart, that's what we want. So come on, let's give Pastor Roxanne a hand. Praise the Lord. She's going to take that down.
Okay. Today's going to be different than some of the times I share. We don't have overheads, so it would probably be helpful because we're going to read a fairly good-sized passage. If you have a Bible, if there's one like in the pew or something like that. Before we do that, I'm going to just say a prayer, okay? We're going to look at John 11. So, Father, we're going to be coming to your word. You are the word. We come to you, Lord Jesus. Above all, Lord, we want to glorify you. We want to see what you have to say for us, Lord. Father, I pray the Holy Spirit will speak to each heart here.
Hallelujah.
Lord, whatever each person needs. Lord, yes. You are the one. You are the one who is the comforter. You're the one who makes a way. And you're the one who has all the answers, every answer. So Amen. We look to you today, God, and we just thank you for your presence. And I just pray, Lord, that you would speak through me and anybody else that you want to use, Father. We're just open to hear from you. And, Lord, I thank you for each one. In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Okay, so I, let me open this up so it's not running into the stand. There. Do it this way. It keeps hitting this down. Okay, so... You know, I like to talk about the feast and the summit, and actually I've taught on other things too, but today is going to be in the other things lane. I was looking at what happened before Palm Sunday and what happened before Jesus went to the cross, and it's a story in John. It's not in all of the books, but it is, or all of the Gospels, I should say, but it is in John. So, and it's a story familiar. You probably heard this if you went to church when you were a kid. In fact, when I started looking up, you know, John 11, almost all the material was children's material. It wasn't for adults. It was like children's material. But anyway, we're going to hear about Lazarus today. And so we're going to kind of go more study style, like verse by verse. But I think what I'm going to do, it's a longer passage, I'm going to just read through it, and you guys can hang with me, and then we'll kind of go back and hit some things that were like questions. And I looked at it from different angles. You can look at it from, you know, Jesus's angle, and then Mary and Martha's and all. And I actually kind of had something light out, and then, like, I think it was yesterday morning or day before yesterday, I woke up and... Anyway, I got a slightly different angle again. So anyway, so I'm just going to go with what I felt, and then we'll see where we go. Okay, so John 11. Now a certain man was sick, Lazarus of Bethany, the town. I don't like this thing. Hold on. Okay, there. Lazarus of Bethany. The town of Mary and her sister Martha. It was that same Mary who anointed the Lord with fragrant oil and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Therefore, the sisters sent to him, talking about Jesus, saying, Lord, behold, he whom you love is sick. When Jesus heard that, he said, this sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God may be glorified through it. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that he was sick, he stayed two more days in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to his disciples, let's go to Judea again. The disciple says to him, Rabbi, lately the Jews sought to stone you, and you are going there again? Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours in a day? If anyone walks in the day, he does not stumble because he sees the light of this world. But if he walks in the night, he stumbles because the light's not in him. These things he said, and after that he said to them, our friend Lazarus sleeps, but I go that I might wake him up. Then his disciples said, Lord, if he sleeps, he'll get well. However, Jesus spoke of his death, but they thought he was speaking about taking rest in sleep. Then Jesus said to them plainly, Lazarus is dead, and I'm glad for your sakes that I was not there, that you may believe. Nevertheless, let's go to him. Then Thomas, who is also called a twin, said to his fellow disciples, let us also go, that we may die with him. So when Jesus came, he found that he had already been in the tomb 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had joined the women around Martha and Mary to comfort them concerning their brother. Now Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him. But Mary was sitting in the house. Now Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, I know whatever you ask of God, God will give you." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know he'll rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he will live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe you're the Christ, the Son of God, who has come into the world." And when she had said these things, she went her way and secretly called Mary, her sister, saying, "The teacher's coming. He's calling for you." As soon as she heard that, she arose quickly and came to him. Now Jesus had not yet come to the town, but was in the place where Mary met him. And then the Jews who were with her in the house and comforting her, when they saw Mary, that she rose up quickly and went out, followed her, saying, "She's going to the tomb to weep there." Then when Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she fell down at his feet, saying to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." Therefore, when Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who came with her weeping, he groaned in his spirit and was troubled. And he said, "Where have you laid him?" And they said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, "See how he loved him." And some of them said, "Could not this man who opened the eyes of the blind also have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus again, groaning in himself, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone lay against it. And Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of him who was dead, said to him, "Lord, by this time there's a stench, for he's been dead 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not say to you that if you would believe, you would see the glory of God?" They took away the stone from the place where the dead man was lying, and Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me, and I know that you always hear me. But because of this people who are standing by, I said this, that they may believe that you sent me." Now when he had said these things, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come forth." And he who had died came out bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was wrapped with a cloth. And Jesus said to them, "Loose him and let him go." So that is the whole story. Well, that's the story of Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead in context with what was going on right then. And so we're going to go back. Some of it is very clear to understand. There were a few parts. Maybe you guys get it better than me, but there was a few parts when I read it, I'm thinking, you know, this doesn't sound, you know, quite right. So I studied those parts out to see if I could, you know, get it. And so that's what we're going to do today. So we're going to go back to start kind of at the beginning and work our way through. So it starts out that there was a certain man sick, Lazarus of Bethany. I'm just going to say in Hebrew, Bethany is Beit Ani. Beit means house, like Bethlehem, right. House of bread. Beit Lechem, which is house of bread. This is Beit Ani. So basically, the Ani part means poor. It means that this was probably a poorer region. It's about 2 miles from Jerusalem. And they would have lived in the house of the poor. Or we might say poorhouse today. I can remember my parents say that, you know. We're not going to be in the poorhouse, you know. It could have been that their parents weren't alive because they're not ever mentioned. It's always Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. It's not, they never talk about their parents, which could be a possible reason. But there was a brother, Lazarus, and two sisters living together. The next little section, it talks about, well, the girls say, Lord, he whom you love is sick. And then down in verse 5, it says again, now Jesus loved Martha, her sister, and Lazarus. It may have been that most, I think what I had read is that a lot of, probably Martha was older. She was mentioned first. And when, there's another story about Mary and Martha, and she was in the kitchen cooking and taking care of business. So she probably would have been the one who was older and had the responsibilities of, you know, things that a younger person might not have had. But we know that Jesus loved Lazarus. And so we also see, where am I at? They were, the girls, everybody was close to Jesus. This is the same Mary who anoints Jesus' feet. Actually, it's in chapter 12, so that's the next chapter over. But she anoints Jesus' feet with a pound of very, that's a lot, a very costly fragrant oil. And she wiped her feet with her hair. That's in John 12:3. So this is a family of siblings that followed Jesus. They visited together. Jesus ate at the table with the family. And they were very, very, very close friends. So then they send word they send words to Jesus that Lazarus is sick. This is a part, one of the parts that didn't sound like, you know, kind of normal in natural thinking. And you know what? Our first impulse is to think things in the natural, right? And then we have to pray about, God, what am I missing here? But Jesus has says, so when he heard that he was sick, he stays 2 more days where he was. I'm going, what? You know, if you're best friends, you know, they say, come, Jesus, you know, he's really, really bad. And then you say, he stays 2 more days where he was. And then after that, he says to the disciples, let's go to Judea again. Here's this whole next section is kind of like you're back and forth with what sounds logical and what doesn't. And then all of the disciples that's there with him, and he happens to be down on the Jordan, kind of close to the area where John the Baptist baptized people. So he's like a 2 days walk because they walked. He's like 20 miles. So he's like 2 days away if he left right now. And he decides to stay 2 days first, and then, you know, you got to get yourself there. And the guys with him are saying, what? Judea is where they're stoning you. They want to stone you. And we're with you, you know. And then Thomas, who in one place in the Bible is called Doubting Thomas, he says, yeah, we'll go with you and we'll die with you, you know. So some of this is kind of, and then Jesus answers after this happens and his friends are kind of like, you know, questioning him about why he was to go back to where they want to kill him. Then Jesus says, are there not 12 hours in a day? If anyone walks in the day, he doesn't stumble, because he sees the light of the world. But if he walks in the night, he stumbles because the light's not in him. Mm-hmm. And then he says, our friend Lazarus sleeps, but I must go and wake him up. So it was a, I'm moving on to the next page. So the people around him thought they were just saying at first that Lazarus was sick, or he was asleep, he was resting in sleep. There is an ancient, I don't know if it's still a common thought, but there was belief that a person's spirit, if a person died, you know, they didn't have the medical stuff that we have today, right? So they thought, well, he could like hover or be around for about 3 days. And so if the fourth day, you know, they could, maybe he's in a coma, maybe something else, you know. But after 3 days, it was like, that's it, you're gone. So hindsight, as they say, is 20/20. So when you're looking behind, for a person to be dead for 4 days and get raised back to life, that's like a miracle. If it had only been 2 days, if he left immediately, they could have said, especially the skeptics could have said, well, it's only 2 days. Maybe he was in a coma, maybe, you know, whatever. But there could have cast doubt on it. But 4 days, there was clearly no doubt. So then Jesus goes into this 12 hours in a day. If anyone walks in the day, he doesn't stumble. So what is that about? So, you know, I always kind of look for, I like it really plain. And it just kind of, so this could be a description, 12 hours in a day, of a limited time for Jesus to fulfill his destiny. Jesus came so that no one would perish. He's saying, we got to get up. There's only, you know, there's 12 hours in a day. And if you're in the day, if you're in the light, you're going to walk in the light and you're not going to stumble. If you're in the dark, you will stumble. Jesus came so no one would perish, that we all might be saved. And he was devoted first and foremost to hearing the Father's voice. He didn't move out a step. He didn't move out of time. But he was devoted to hearing his Father's voice. He had already said, the sickness isn't unto death, but for the glory of God, so that the Son of God might be glorified through it. We also have a limited time to do what the Father says. We don't maybe have as clear a picture, but we need to wait on God until we get a picture. Especially sometimes when the Lord starts speaking to you, you know, you kind of get the sense on the inside of you. And you start thinking about that. You start researching about it. As time goes on, Mike used to say it's like a bubbling. It's a churning in you. And it's a stirring to this. Maybe you should look at this. Maybe you should look at that. But then you just keep seeking the Lord until things get more clear. There are almost always, I mean, there's still things I have questions about God, like why this or why that, but we'll get to that in a minute. But we also have a limited time on earth. If we obey the Lord, we will not stumble with our choices, because we will see the light of the world. Who is the light of the world? Jesus. He said, I am the light of the world. Jesus went on and said, if anyone walks in the night without the light, who is himself, he's going to stumble because the light's not in him. Even us who have the light, if we lean to our own understanding, you know, we can stumble because the natural mind is enmity with the spiritual. It's enmity with God because we think according to the flesh. We think, okay, we usually think about ourselves, you know. We need this, or I need to get this done, or, well, you know, we're taking care of business for ourselves and our families and things like that. And it's not that we might stumble in that, but we do need to bring these things to the Lord. Because his timing is not always the same as we can see here. He waited 2 days, you know. So that right there says something about his timing. Proverbs 3:5-6. This was one of my mom's favorite verses. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not to your own understanding. In all your ways, submit to him, and he will make your path straight. Hallelujah. We have to walk by faith. Trust God. Not considered natural circumstances. That is not easy to do, as it wasn't in this circumstance for Mary and Martha. It was, there may be times it doesn't make sense, but we're going to trust in God, because without faith, it's impossible to please God. So we get to the reunion with Mary and Martha, or Martha and Mary, because he puts Martha. So verse 17, so when Jesus came, he found that he, Lazarus, had been in the tomb for 4 days. Now Martha, as soon as she heard Jesus was coming, she met him, but Mary was sitting in the house. Now Martha says to Jesus, first thing, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. She had faith that God could raise him up. Amen. So where was he? Yeah. Right?
Come on.
You can hear the frustration. I listened to a lot of sermons on this. One of them was saying, you know, in today's word, probably Jesus would have been met with, "You're late." You know, where were you? You know, we sent word. You know, we sent word. Anyway, so she's, you know, but you can hear. She might not have said it. She might have been more torn up, you know. But you can hear the disappointment, the hurt, the frustration, grief over her brother's death.
Yes.
Then she adds, so to Martha's credit, she's been listening to the Lord. She says, "But even now, I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you." And Jesus says, "Your brother will rise again." Martha says, I love this back and forth, that no matter if we have a question, if we don't get it, if we feel something, or if we're disappointed or something about something, just your flat-out honest hearts, yes, without anything else, God takes that, and he's not offended by our comeback, I'll call it, for lack of knowing what else to call it. But it blesses me, because we don't have to hide anything when we're talking to Jesus. He knows where we are anyway. So we don't have to, we can just be honest.
Amen.
Martha comes back with, and this is good, you know, points for Martha. She says, I know he'll rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Yeah. So even in this heartbreaking situation of losing her brother, she's quoting back words that Jesus has said about himself, that he would rise again in the last day. But Jesus comes back. Have you ever said something to Jesus, and Jesus comes back to you, and you read a verse that doesn't negate what you just said, yes, but it clarifies maybe what he's meaning for you right now? Yes. Jesus comes back, and he says, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. So even when we die, and everybody will die, I mean, unless Jesus comes. But even when we die, or a person dies, they live if they know the Lord, if they have the light. And he who lives and believes in me shall never die. Never die. So death is not the end. Death is the beginning. It's the beginning to eternity. It's beginning of being in the presence of the God, presence of the Lord, presence of God, 100% of the time. Martha says, yes, Lord, I believe you're the Christ, the Son of God, who is come into the world. And I'm thinking, wow, even in this period of disappointment and misunderstanding, she is saying, you are the Christ, the Son of God, who's come into the world. So then, I'm gathering, it doesn't say in the Bible, but I'm gathering there must have been other people there. We know other disciples came with him. But Martha leaves. She runs home secretly, calls Mary, and says, the master wants to see you. So while the house is full of people who are also mourning, Mary gets up, leaves him, takes off, and she's going to run out and see Jesus at the place where Martha had gone earlier. And so all these other people who are there to support her, they get up too, and they think that she's going to Lazarus' tomb. So they get up, and they think, well, we're going to follow her. So when Mary, we're at verse 32. So when Mary came to where Jesus was, she fell down at his feet. And what does she say? Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. Again, the honest personal grief and disappointment that Jesus had not come, that he had seemingly done nothing, even though they had called for him. And the Jews who had come with her were also weeping. This was a heavy, heavy, disappointing time Have you ever been disappointed with God's timing?
Oh, yes.
Probably we all have. Our timing is like now. We call on the Lord, we bring our prayer requests to the Lord, and we say, God, we're saying, where are you? Just like Mary and Martha said, where are you? You know, we need you. We're desperate. We have no other hope if you don't show up.
Right.
We've also probably thought he's late. You know, we always come back in the church and say, Jesus is never late. He's always on time. But in our day-to-day walk, sometimes it feels like he's 4 days late or longer. Mm-hmm. You know, God gave Abraham a promise that he would have a son, and I think it was 40 years. It was like long time. And so sometimes we walk in faith a long time. And so we want to be encouraged that that God still shows up. So verse 33, when Jesus saw her weeping, he groaned in his spirit and was troubled because Jesus loved them. The one thing is Jesus always loves. He loved them from the day they were just buddies, you know, and he shared time with them. He loved them even in delaying, and we'll get to that. He says, so he's groaning, he's troubled. I heard that the word used for groaned here in the Greek, I haven't studied Greek, I'd kind of like to, but I want to really get Hebrew. Anyway, it means like a horse snorting in anger. So if you can imagine a horse that's, you know, I don't know, you've seen them kind of rear up and snort and stomp around. So it says here, he groaned in the spirit and was troubled. It's the word for groaned. And Jesus said, where have you laid him? Jesus wept.
He wept.
This is the shortest verse in the Bible. It probably has some of the most power in it because I think that when we pray, and we're tired of our situation, not every situation, not like your whole life, but some aspect of it that you're praying for, you've been standing in faith for. Right. God, you're my help. Jesus feels that. I think he felt the weight of this family that loved him, waiting on him, feeling their disappointment, being grieved that his friend has died, all of these things. He is still loving.
Hallelujah.
Then in this sad situation, we see that, where am I at? The word says he sees every tear that falls. Just because he delays does not mean he doesn't love. He was loving in this delay as he was about to reveal a greater glory. Then we got these people who probably don't know Jesus quite as well, but they're friends with Mary and Martha. And some of them said, could not this man who opened the eyes of the blind, because everybody here has heard what Jesus has done around, you know, in that area especially, couldn't he have kept this man from dying? This, you know, and so this is probably what they had thought, only they might not have put words to it. It says in verse 38, Jesus again groaned in himself. Same word. He came to the tomb, and it was a cave, a stone that laid against it. And Jesus says, take away the stone. So Martha, again, probably being the older, she says to him, Lord, by this time there's a smell, and he's been dead 4 days. And Jesus comes back with, did I not say to you that if you would believe, you would see the glory of God?
There you go.
And they removed the stone, you know. Sometimes we can have a situation where we've been standing for a long time, and we might be so sick of it, it feels dead. It's not going to happen. I've had situations where at the time, this has happened more than once, I give up. I give up, and I say, okay, God, maybe that's not what you had for me. I remember when we wanted to buy a house. I mean, this is a carnal thing. We had always done campus ministry and started ministry. So for the first 30, 40 years of our life, or not that long, probably 25 years of our life, I mean, we had nothing. It was, we were, you know, so we had nothing. We were in the poorhouse. And I wanted a house so bad. And so anyway, finally I got to the point. I prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed. Finally I got to the point. I said, okay, God, if you're okay with it, I'm okay with it. But it took a lot to lay it down. You know what I'm saying? It took a lot to lay it down. It's like, if you're okay with, help me not to complain, I'm letting it go out the door. And it wasn't too long after. I think I had, like, this sounds like nothing, you know, for buying a house. But I think I had, I was started working. I think I had saved like $20,000. And my mom never gave us money, really, to speak of. Like, well, we were getting started. Even when we were in campus ministry, starving, you know, living in the back of the church, blah, blah, blah. They never did. But she married Howard, and Howard said, he came in. She says, this was Howard's idea. She sent us $20,000. So I had $40,000. And so then by the time, at that time, I had started working at Dean Witter. And I'm like, well, let's invest it. Let's make more out of this, you know, blah, blah, blah. And then when Mike found out I had $40,000, he wanted to go house hunting. It wasn't still that much. But anyway, so these are the kind of things that happen, little obstacles. So then we found a house we kind of liked. And Pastor Mark came up and said, I don't think you should get a house right now.
Well, I remember that.
And I'm thinking, butt out. I have been praying for a house for 25 years or more.
Yeah.
You know, I don't want to hear. Now that I've got a little bit of money, now is not the time. But I'm like, God, if you're okay with this, I'm okay with this, kind of, sort of. I'm okay with this, you know. And you just let the emotion go out again. Almost always, emotion will make you make a bad decision. You know, it gets you in the natural. So anyway, we let it go. And about 6-8 months later, we went by that house, and it was still for sale. And they dropped the price, and interest rates had fallen, and da-da-da-da-da. Yeah. And so we checked it out again. We ended up getting that house. But we got it with better rates. You know, we got it at a better price. So anyway, God is still faithful. So now we have a house. Amen. Praise God. We have a place to go. So where am I at? Okay. So they removed the stone. And Jesus prays. He says, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I know that you are always hear me. But this is the reason. Because of the people who are standing by, I said this, that they may believe that you sent me. This is why all this stuff has happened, all these confusing things, all this stuff we don't totally get. Jesus was delaying. That was part of it. Lazarus had to die. He was dead for 4 days. All the family disappointment, the hurt. But because of the people standing by, that they might believe that God has sent him. Because why? Jesus came so that all might believe, so that none would perish. So if there's a delay, I'm just going to throw this out. This is just a thought. But if there's a delay over something you've been sending word to Jesus, like come quick, start praying, and it's a delay. It's like getting old to you. Start praying for a greater miracle in the lives of people around you. When they see the power of God undeniable in your life, it opens them up so that God can do miraculous things in them. So this is just something that we can think about, that it even comes to our mind, that we get our mind off of our own situation for a little bit. Thinking, what God, are you going to do something greater here?
Come on, hallelujah.
And then I wanted to just say that Jesus always loves. He was loving Martha, Mary, and Lazarus from the get-go. He gave himself for us. While we wait for him to show up and we don't understand what's going on just like them, he forgives our shortcomings. He doesn't get, he doesn't take offense to us questioning in him. He wants us to know him. He wants us to understand. So, you know, he does speak in parables, no question. But he wants us to press into him for what are you saying and what do I need to get? So he says, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he will live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. And as he said to Martha, he probably says to us, do you believe this? And we have to take a stand. We have to make like a line in the dirt. I remember, I've probably talked about this, but I got really discouraged when we were in campus ministry. Everybody, we were in Beverly Hills, Brentwood, you know, this is like Hollywood, this is like the ritzy richest whatever, maybe outside of New York on earth. And we were, couldn't pay our $600 a month rent. And they gave us $750 a month we had $750 a month coming in. Our rent was $600. I had Holly, and Jeremy was born there. He was born in Santa Monica.
Right.
We had no medical. So I'm talking every week or month, Mike would say, we're not going to make it this month. You know, it was just stressful. And so I wasn't like saying I'm going to give up on Jesus necessarily, but I was so discouraged with our life. And I woke up one morning, and the little song, old song, was going through my brain, and it says, I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. And you know what? We have to, no matter what is not working or feels like it's not working, we have to say, God, if this is okay with you, make it okay with me. Change my heart. Turn my mind. Get me where you need. I need to see things like you're seeing things. And then, you know, we need to make, if things come that we don't get, we have to say, no matter what, no matter what, I'm in, Lord. I am in 100%. I'm going to trust you.
Yes,
hallelujah. So there's actually a song I want us to hear, but I want us to sign off to our YouTube family because I don't know, I'm not sure about rights if we can upstream it. So we're going to say goodbye to the YouTube family. Next week is going to be Palm Sunday. It's going to be awesome, awesome, awesome. Pastor Roberts is going to have it. And Lady Crystal, awesome. She's worshiping leader. So we're just going to say goodbye to them, and then we're going to upload this song. It's a little bit long, and this is a song that is on plays on Air One. It plays on, what am I thinking? Yeah. Is it playing? Oh, you haven't played it. Okay, that's okay. It might be loud. This is just a song of, I'm going to trust you, God. I trust you. It's a little bit long. If it gets too long, we can dial it back. But we'll just listen for a bit.
Jesus is mine.
On the screen.
He's been my father.